it off the atmosphere. Shift it with your faith now.
Hallelujah! Heaven comes to fight.
begin to lift up your hallelujah. Raise it like a banner. Raise it like a flag. Raise it in the middle of the storm. Let it rise. Let it rise. Like a symphony to the King. Everything. We'll be right back.
Good morning to each and every one of you on this Sunday morning. This is a new month. Exciting news that we've moved from stage 5 to stage 4 in this new month. Just started from the 1st of May. And may I say this, as it's in the month of may I say this morning, may God grant you favor in this month. May God shine His face upon you, and may He be gracious to each and every one of us. Yes, I've got an expectation this morning in my heart for the month of May, that we will see how God will turn things around. That we will see as we turn towards God. Just remember that we heard the word that said, you know, humble yourself and pray and see God's face. Turn towards God, and may we see turnarounds this month. Let's trust God. I trust this morning, before you're going to share the word, that there's expectation in your heart. We're in a new season. We're close to winter, and it's a new season that we're going in again. And I trust that we will see turnarounds this month as we come before God. Let's just pray together and see God's face for the word this morning. Father, thank you. Thank you again for a Sunday morning. Thank you, Lord, although we are not in this building, but thank you that we can come together in homes. Thank you that we can be church. Thank you that we can be light in the times of crisis, in a time of calamity. Thank you that we can come and seek your face. And again, Father, it's such an honor, it's such a privilege to come and bow down before you. Thank you, Lord, that you are with us. Thank you for your grace. Thank you for your Holy Spirit. Thank you for your word this morning. Thank you for the children of God. Thank you for people that are standing in faith and people that are praying. Thank you that we can know and be aware of the fact that we are carried by God. Lord, it's an awesome moment and an awesome opportunity this morning again just to open your word. And I want to pray, Lord, that you will come and that you will share your word with each and every one of us. We honor the word of God. And thank you that we can embrace your word this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Praise God. I want to start off this morning and with a few scriptures. And I'm going to read these different scriptures to you. My theme this morning is stand still. Stand still. So let me start with a few scriptures. I'm starting with Exodus 14, verse 13 to 14. It says the following. Moses were talking to the Israelites, and it says in verse 13, but Moses told the people, don't be afraid. Just stand still and watch the Lord rescue you today. The Egyptians you see today, will never be seen again. The Lord himself will fight for you. Just stay calm. If you've got a pen this morning and your Bible is open, I want you to underline those words, just stand still. And if you want to, please go and write today's date with that. I believe this is a word that God gave me, a word that is for now, that says, I want you to see what I'm going to do, but you need to stand still. So underline that, write today's date with it, you know what, and see what's going to come out of this from this moment. Psalm 46 verse 10, David comes and he says, be still and know that I am God. Again, can you underline that word, be still? Be still and know that I am God. And then it says, I will be honored by every nation. I will be honored throughout the world. People, listen to the word of God. It's so encouraging to read this. God says, everybody will honor me. The fear of God will come upon people. I will be honored by every nation. Everybody in this world will honor God. God is ready to pour out more of his glory. But there's something that we need to do. Stand still. Be quiet. Be still and know that he is God. And another scripture is, the third scripture is in Habakkuk 2 verse 14 that says, truly my purposes will be accomplished. Truly my purposes will be accomplished. Remember the word of God? You know what? The word of God teaches us that we will not live from bread alone, but every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. And it also says that the word of God will never return void, that it will accomplish what its purpose is. And yeah, it comes through the prophet and he says, truly, God says, my purposes will be accomplished. What is in the heart of God will be accomplished in our day and in our time. And then he carries on and he says, and my glory will cover the earth, even as the waters cover the sea. My glory, you will see my glory. People, more and more and more, we've got a hunger and we've got a thirst to see the glory of God. And God comes and he makes a promise that says, I will accomplish my purpose. And I will cover this earth with my glory. People will turn to me. Let me take a step back and give you some background. You know what, where Moses, where we started in Exodus. Moses with the Israelites, you know what, they came out of Egypt. And as they came out of Egypt, you know what, they were not in the promised land yet. But they found themselves at a place where they had the enemy behind them and they were facing the Red Sea. Now just for a moment, just think yourself in that position. They were standing seemingly at a place of an impossible future. To know that the enemy is behind me and to know that I'm standing in front of the Red Sea, this is a wall that is in front of us. What is our future going to be? A moment of confusion, a moment of uncertainty, a moment of fear, a moment of doubt. And in that moment, God comes through Moses and he says to the Israelites, stand still. Stand still and see. Church, I want to say to you this morning, whatever you're facing at this moment, whatever we're facing at this moment, God says, stand still and see. Let me bring this closer to home this morning. Our context in this lockdown at this moment, worldwide, for us as a nation, but also globally, everybody is saying, what are we going to do? What are we going to do? What are we going to do? What's going to be the outcome of this? How long? What's going to happen with this? What's going to happen with that? It's happening with everybody. You know what? There hasn't been a cure yet for COVID-19. We know that they're busy working on a vaccine, and I believe if I read the different posts, you know what, that Israel is very close to that, you know what, and there's prophetically, they said that it will come out of Israel, you know what, but it's not there yet. If we listen to medical experts says to us that it's vital to keep the country close, and that all people will maintain to stay at home, you know what, so that we can fight this COVID-19. Death tolls are rising, you know, globally, dramatically, day by day. We're still aware of it. And if you ask the question, are we fine? Most people will say to you, everything is not fine. Everything is not fine, you know what? People are not financially free. I think most people are probably financially frustrated. And I can add to that, emotionally, physically, relationally, we're all at a place where we need to, where we struggle to maintain the living in the restriction that we're in, and to do life as we used to. So yes, there's that frustration. So we find ourselves similar to Israel, between a there and a there, or a here and a there. You know, We've got the enemy behind us. We're facing a Red Sea. We're not sure what's going to come out of this. What are we going to do? And if you read the Bible, people, everyone in the Bible went through something. It was just called something different. Every time there was a different name to it, towards it. For instance, Noah. You know, Noah went through something, and in that time it was called the flood. Abram went through something, and that time it was called Mount Moriah. Moses went through something, and it was called a desert experience. The Israelites went through it, and it was called the wilderness. Elijah went through it, and it was called Zarephath. The three Hebrew boys went through it, and it was called the fiery furnace. Daniel went through it, and it was called the lion's den. Paul went through it, and it was called prison. You and I, we are going through it. We are experiencing this time, and it's called COVID-19. We need to understand, everyone in the Bible went through something, but in everything that they went through, there was a purpose. Come on, guys, we need to acknowledge that. We need to know that as we're going through this, there was always a purpose. There was a reason why. Understand that this place where we find ourselves in, that God is busy developing your and my character at this moment. He's busy with us. During this time, God is saying to us as a church, and I want to quote from the Word of God. God is saying to you and me in 1 Peter 2 verse 9, He says, you are my chosen people. I've chosen you to follow me. I've paid the ultimate price. You're mine. You belong to me. You're my chosen people. You're a royal priesthood. You're royalty. You belong to the King of Kings. You're mine. You're my special possession. You're a holy nation. You've been set aside for my purposes and for my plans. And I will work through you because I've set you aside, you know, so that my holiness and my plans will be accomplished through you. Can I remind you, church, you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's special possession, that you may declare the praises of Him, says the Word, who called you out of darkness into His marvelous light, or into His wonderful light. It says that as we're going through this, we need to praise God. Do not stop to praise God, because God is with us and God is busy with us. Do not stop to praise God. The reason why we're going through the wilderness, the reason why we're between there and there, is God is busy working with you and with me. He's busy with us. God said to us, you know what, that he first needs to get our attention. And God's got our attention in the world. He's got everybody's attention. People are turning towards God. People are humbling themselves before God. People are praying at this moment. You know what? People are drawing closer to God. God, and as they draw closer to God, God says, okay, now I can work with you. Now I can build your character. Now I can work with your heart. Because I want to change you. I want to transform you. I want to change you more into my image. You see, God is trying to get you to a point that you'll be able to stand in the midst of where we are. To be real, to be authentic in this moment, people, not just to rush through it. God is busy and he's trying to get us to be able to stand in the midst of this with confidence, with comfort, even with joy, by saying, we're going through things. We're standing in COVID-19 at this moment, you know, but we're not standing in the ability of man. We're not standing in the might of our government, or we're not standing in the power of our economy. We're standing in Christ. We're standing in God. Take a stand, you know what? Stand still. Stand still and see what I will do. Watch this. In Exodus 14, God was busy with Moses, and in Exodus 14 verse 15 it says, then the Lord said to Moses, Moses, why are you crying out to me? Tell the people to get moving. Why are you crying out to me? You see, Moses was not praying to God, saying, Lord, we know that you will never leave us or forsake us. He was not saying to God, we know, Lord, that you've actually, you brought us out of Egypt, you know what, and you've saved us from the hand of Pharaoh, we know that you can do that. That's not what he said to God. He didn't say to God, Lord, we know that you're able to do exceedingly abundantly above whatever we can ask or pray for. Well, he was not saying that to God. He was standing in a place and he was crying out to God. And probably, you know what, if we really real about this, he was standing in front of the Red Sea with a puzzled face. Perhaps with that strange look on his face with the Israelites, almost saying, Lord, now what? Lord, now what? You brought us out of Egypt, and now we're standing in front of the Red Sea. Lord, now what? Lord, what are you going to do? What are we going to do at this moment? Similar to that, we sometimes look at one another, you know, as we are bombarded with the news, and as we receive daily fresh news and medical reports regarding where we are at this moment. And sometimes we all sit and we've got that strange look on our face, almost like, sure, what now, Lord? Where is this going to end? What's going to happen? What's going to happen with businesses? What's going to happen with students in varsity? What's going to happen with our children in school? What's going to happen with opening doors? And what's going to happen with church? How's things going to roll out? You know what? This word says it's totally up to God. It's totally up to God. It is a time to stand still and see the salvation of the Lord. It's a time to see how God will rescue us. It's a time to stand and see what God will do. You may say to me this morning, but if we stand still, the economy will collapse. If we stand still, businesses will never be restored again or recover again. If we stand still, political structures will fall. If we stand still, we will die. Whoa, listen to the word of God. Let me tell you what's the benefit of standing still this morning. Listen to this. You see, when you stand still, you and I are at a position where God can show us something. God can show us something. God can teach us something in this moment. So many times we think that we've got it all sorted out. So many times we think, you know, I know what to do, and I know how I will respond in this, and I will respond in that. And when you actually get there, you realize that, you know what, I'm just messing this up. I actually do not know how. But if we would just stand still and watch God be God. Watch God be God in your situation, in our situation. The benefits of standing still. You know the scripture very well, Isaiah 40 verse 30, 31, that says, they that wait upon the Lord, they that stand still, they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. This word is a promise that God says, you will have strength in this moment. I will renew your strength. You will have power. You will have strength to stand and to wait and to see what I will do. You will have strength. That's one of the benefits when you stand still. You will have power. You will be able to do what you need to do. It also says that when you stand still, God is busy teaching you and me patience. Now, if you read your Bible according to Galatians 5:22, that you will know that patience is one of the fruit of the Spirit. So that means that you and I need to yield to the Spirit of God. You need to yield to what God's Spirit is saying to you. You need to yield to the move of God's Spirit in this time, so that you will have the fruit of patience in your life. Patient to do that, allow God to do what He needs to do, and not for you to try to figure it out, not for you to complicate things, not for you to get all the answers. I know most people out there, it's got the question mark on them by saying, what now? What now? What now? What about my children? What about my business? What about church? How are we going to do this? What's going to be the next? You know what? God is busy with you and me, and probably busy teaching us patience. And the more we yield to the Spirit of God, people, He will come and He will shape our character. He will transform us more and more to His image and His likeness. You see, another benefit of standing still is that you'll be able to hear God. If you've been in a room where there's 10 or 20 people and everybody is talking at the same time, it's impossible to hear what everybody is saying. Please, just one person at a time, so that you can be able to hear. You see, when you stand still, you're able to hear what God is saying. You're able to hear what He's instructing you to do, and you're not distracted. That happened with Moses. For Moses to really be pivotal in leading and helping Israel, the Israelites, to move into the promised land, he had to receive instructions. So that means he had to hear the voice of God. You see, without God's instructions, Moses was lost. Without God's leadership, without His guidance, he was not successful, or he will not be successful to move forward. He had to receive God's leadership, God's instructions. And for you and me to be successful, to save other people, to save the economy, to gather again in worship and to come together in church, you know what? We need to stand still and receive instructions from God. We need to be instructed by God. Anlie Stanley, I read an article of Anlie Stanley, and he was speaking about faith, and I want to quote him. He said the following. He says, faith is not how we get God to do stuff. That's not faith. Faith is not how we get God to do stuff for us. It's not a superpower. He comes and he says, true faith is confidence that God already did something. Faith is simply confidence that God is who God reveals Himself to be in the New Testament, and that He will do everything He promised. That's faith. We said last week, you know what? It's impossible to stand firm without faith. Yeah, if you're not engaged in faith and not use your faith, people, you're going to stand on one leg and you'll not be able to stand. So faith is to trust God. You know, faith is simply the confidence in that what God already did. God is busy, people, and we need to trust God. We need to stand still and let God do the leading. Interesting again. Watch this. When it comes to Moses, it was not Moses that led the people out of Israel. It was God. Moses was instrumental. He was the man at that moment that God used. But it was not him that led the people out of Israel. It was God. It says there in Exodus 13 verse 21, it says, and the Lord God went before them by day in a pillar of a cloud, to lead them, listen to this, to lead them the way, and by night in a pillar of fire to give them light to go by day and by night. The Lord led them. It was not Moses. The Lord led them. Moses was just following the instructions of God. He just did what God told him to do. And we need to follow God's instructions. God will do the leading. God will show us exactly. He will do the leading. He will lead us in the day and in the night, you know. But we need to follow the instructions. And whatever, if God's going to use government, then we need to listen to what government is saying. Medical practitioners, listen to what doctors are saying, you know. Whoever God is going to use, He will instruct you to do. We need to follow the instructions. Oh, church, let me encourage you this morning. Jeremiah 31 verse 33 says, "But this is the new covenant I will make with my people of Israel after those days, says the Lord." He comes and he says, "I will put my instructions deep within them, and I will write them on their hearts, and I will be their God, and they will be my people." God says, "I will give you the instructions. I will do the leading. Don't you worry about this. Stand still and watch. See the salvation of the Lord." But you need to be instructed. And here comes God, and He says, "I will give you the instructions." Statistics says to us, you know, that 64% of men and 24% of women never read instructions when it comes to equipment. They never do that. You know what? It's always just start using the equipment. What if the instructions? How can you follow something if you do not read the instructions? And here comes God, and He says, "But what if I put the instructions in your heart? What if the instructions is already in your heart and already in your mind? It's already there. You just need to follow it. You hear it day by day. What if it's already there?" God comes and he makes the promise. He says, "I will be your God." Come on, church. Let's allow God to be God for where we are. I really want to encourage you with this. Let's allow God to be God for where we are. He said, "I will be your God and you will be my people." We need to stand still and allow God to be God in our lives in this current situation. Now, here's the exciting news. If you read these scriptures, God says, "I will do the miraculous." Because if we stand and see, we will see what? We will see how God will rescue us. We will see how He is a miracle worker, how He will come through for us. We will see that. We will see how He will come and pour out His glory upon where we are, because He said everybody, all nations, the whole world will see the glory of God. But we need to stand back and allow Him just to be God, without all or asking all the questions. Daniel was told that if he prayed to any god except the king, that he would be thrown in the lion's den. And what did Daniel do? He decided to stand still and pray to God anyhow, because he decided that God can perform a miracle. God can shut the mouths of the lions when He stands in that lion's den. And that's what God did. When you and I qualify here for a miracle, Lord, come and do the miraculous in our hearts. Come and do the miraculous in our situation. As we stand in what we call COVID-19, as we stand and we face things, thank you, Lord, that you can come and do the miraculous. Come and do the miraculous. Let me remind you of another scripture. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were told either to bow down to a golden image or to be thrown into the fiery furnace. And they decided to stand still. Let me read this to you. I'd like to read this to you. Hear it for yourself. Daniel 3, verse 16 to 18, it says, "Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego replied to him, 'King Nebuchadnezzar, we do not need to defend ourselves before you in this matter. If we are thrown into this blazing furnace, the God we serve is able to deliver us from it, and He will deliver us from your majesty's hand. But even if He does not, we want you to know, your majesty, that we will not serve your gods or worship the image of gold you have set before us.'" Let's jump to verse 24. And then it says in verse 24, "Then King Nebuchadnezzar leaped to his feet in amazement and asked his advisors, 'Weren't these the three men that were tied up and threw into the fire?' And they replied, 'Certainly, your majesty.' He said, 'Look, I see four men walking around in the fire, unbound, unharmed, and the fourth looks like the son of the gods.' Nebuchadnezzar then approached the opening of the blazing furnace and shouted, 'Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, servants of the Most High God, come out, come here.' So Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego came out of the fire, and the satraps, the prefects, the governors and royal advisors crowded around them. And they saw that the fire had not harmed their bodies, nor was a hair of their head singed. Their robes were not scorched. There was no smell of fire on them. Then Nebuchadnezzar said, "Praise be to the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who has sent an angel and rescued his servants. See and stand still and see how I will rescue you. See how he rescued his servants." They trusted in him and defied the king's command and were willing to give up their lives rather than serve or worship any god except their own God. Can you see? Can you hear? If we stand still and let God be God, we're going to come out of this miraculously. People, can I tell you, we'll be wondering how did we make it through COVID-19? And we'll be able to tell people of the miracles God did in this time. The miracles how God provided for us. The miracles of how God helped us in business. The miracles how God provided for us financially. The miracles how God provided for us relationally, emotionally, physically, spiritually. We're going to tell people about this. Please hear me. Be expectant of that, because he is a miracle worker. But we need to stand still and see how God will do this. I want to end off. Paul and Silas, they were in jail, you know what, and they were beaten, and at midnight they just decided to stand and start praising God. Stand still and start praising God. You and I need to start praising God more and more and more. It's a time not to run around, but to stand still and praise the Lord. Jesus did exactly the same. Jesus stood still. When they talked to him, he just decided he would stand still. When they lied on him, he just decided he would stand still. In the Garden of Gethsemane, he decided to stand still. When they marched him from the one judgment hall to the next judgment hall, he decided to stand still. When they nailed him to the cross, he decided to stand still. Come on, church. Let's stand still and see the salvation of the Lord. The last scripture I want to share with you is Lamentations 3, verse 25 to 26. It says, "The Lord is good to those whose hope is in him, to the ones who seek him. And listen to this, it is good to wait quietly for the salvation of the Lord." It is good to wait quietly. It's good to stand still and see what God will do. Wait for God to act on your behalf. Wait for the supernatural to come and do this. Victory is yours and it's mine. Can I come and align you this morning? God is ready to come and do much, much more in your life. We are on the first Sunday of this month, and as you know that we usually do communion as a church, and I'd like to share the communion with you just before we're going to pray. Taking communion this morning, I trust that you will take the elements out at home and that you'll remind yourself that victory is ours. That what Christ did on the cross, to know him as crucified, to know what he did, to know that we're standing in the resurrection power. Lord Jesus said, "I want you to remind yourself, take the bread and remind you, my body has been broken for you for a time like this. To stand in the month of May in 2020, I've died on the cross for you. I'm with you. Stand and see how I will rescue you." Also, he took the cup and he said, "This is my blood that speaks of a new covenant." And God made a covenant with you and me, and he said, in this covenant, I will be God to you. Father, we want to allow you to be God. Will you just close your eyes and let's pray with one another. Father, thank you that we can celebrate again the victory that is ours. And as we stand in what we call COVID-19, as we stand in this process, Father, thank you that there is grace for us. Thank you that there's peace for us. Thank you that you're busy with each and every one of us at this moment, Father. And again, we want to remind ourselves. We want to remind ourselves that Christ died on a cross for us so that we can be alive, so that we can stand in the midst of calamity, of the crisis, of COVID-19, and have confidence, have joy, have expectancy that better days are ahead of us. We're going to see how God's going to move on our behalf. Father, I want to pray right now for everyone that's trusting and seeking your face, that you will come and do the miraculous in their lives. Come and remove anxiety. Come and remove the worries, Father. Come and remove the stress. Come and remove what now, Lord? The question, what now? And come and may they see the salvation. Where you sit at this moment, just trust God this morning and receive that miracle that you're trusting God for. As you use these elements, know that God said, I've already, you know, it's already done. Place your faith in me. It's already done. I've died on the cross for you. Victory is yours. Victory is ours this morning. Thank you, Father. Although we're standing in a seemingly impossible future when it comes to the world, we know this morning that our future is secure with you because of Christ. We choose to stand in Christ. We choose to stand in righteousness. We choose to apply your blood to our lives, to our hearts, and to our minds. Thank you, Lord. I invite you, Father, through your Spirit, that your Spirit will lead us and guide us, and that you will come and show your glory. Show your glory to the world out there. Show your glory to every nation, that everyone will bow their knee and confess with their tongues that Jesus Christ is Lord and that God is with us. All glory, all power, and all honor belongs to you. In Jesus' name, amen. May you have a beautiful Sunday. Trust that you will experience the leading of God's Spirit this week and that you'll be instructed daily to stand in the presence of God. Amen. God bless you and have a wonderful week.